about?
Hey, exactly. That's what was trying to come out. I was thinking of a way to say that, okay?
Or not watching anything about it. So the idea in terms of talking about this, and we're going to be talking about this for the next several hours, and here's my thank you. And I know there's courses out there that give you a 30-minute blurb of this, and yet, based on my history, based on my passion about this, I'm going to go fairly deep into this in terms of offering this world up to you, and then as we start working with the labs, we'll put stuff together. So you're stuck with my history in terms of the topic that we're talking about today. So again, just based on experience, my thing with this is I worked in the NICU, a level 2 NICU for about 4.5 years. And in NICU world, there are 3 different levels. There's a level 1, level 2, level 3. Unlike a trauma center, a level 1 is kind of like a community, newborn, nursery type thing. Level 2 is an intermediate type ICU. And a level 3 is the big kahuna, as in Children's Hospital here at Sacred Heart would be a good example. That is a level 3. And so the world that you step into with this is completely different. It's 180 degrees different in many, many different ways than anything else you experience in your life. Generally, folks are not real keen about taking care of a 1-pound, 2-pound kid with all kinds of tubes and all kinds of things you're doing on a daily basis. And so most people run screaming for night about that rather than doing that. And yet I have to tell you that those who are good at it are very, very good at it. And so it's a subspecialty, unlike almost anything else that you step into. I will tell you this, personally, if there was one job I could go back to, this would be it. That's how much that I enjoy this world. But that's just me. I am strange that way. Here's where we're going. We're going to talk a little bit about terminology. We're going to talk a little bit more about fetal development. We kind of scuffed on it the other day. We're going to dig into it today in terms of what happens with development during those first 3 trimesters. We're going to talk about fetal circulation. I mentioned this the other day. We're going to dig into it today. We're going to slow down and talk about that today because it's always confusing. And it always kind of gets people sideways. We'll see if we can't get through that. And then we're going to talk about transitioning from that fetal circulation to what happens in terms of normal newborn and for living life. We're going to talk about some maternal fetal causative factors for neonatal problems. We talked about some of that the other day. We're going to talk some more about that today. We're going to talk a little bit about newborn assessment. We're going to talk a little bit about the resuscitation of the newborn. We're not going to talk about life in the ICU setting. By time, I don't think we're going to have time for it. We're going to talk just a wee bit in terms of bringing these kids home and what that means for you in terms of taking care of them. So there's the numbers. 5 million neonatal deaths per year worldwide. Interesting thing about that, you would think here in the United States we would be number 1 in terms of care. We're not. We're 12. And this was a number of years ago. I don't know what has happened in terms of falling or increasing on this. But the idea in terms of saving these kids' lives, we are not the top kahuna. It's actually Great Britain that is. 10% of newborns require resuscitation. 1% require extensive resuscitation. So get this. We're going to talk about this in the United States today. We're going to talk about those kids that come out with a poor Apgar and that you start to stimulate them, you get them going, everything else like that, and they do fine after that. That's this resuscitation that we're talking about. The 1%ers, the 99%, do well, they'll get me. The 1% is the one that will cause nightmares for y'all. Orthosphyxia accounts for 90% of neonatal deaths. So what do you think in utero birth asphyxia is about? I told you this the other day. It isn't cyst.
Accordion.
Absolutely, it's about a cord. It's about leaning on a cord or a cord gets strapped around the neck or something like that. It's tied in knots. So there's no circulation going to the child. So by far, it's the biggest reason in utero deaths. In the U.S., 80% of 30,000 infants born under 3,500 grams, that's about 3.5 pounds or so, require resuscitation. So low birth weight is synonymous with the possibility of resuscitation. Who did I tell you the other day is high risk for low birth weight?
Smoker.
Moms are smokers, right? Produce that possibility. Although when we get there, I'll talk about that as to sometimes why they do better. It's kind of strange. Early intervention and resuscitation is the key to survival. Your ability and you will have the ability, your ability to figure out who you're going to have to resuscitate and how much you're going to have to do along the way will be the key to you surviving this and the kid perhaps surviving this as well. So you have the goods. Let's talk a little terminology. I'll shut my mouth, I'll let you write. Again, I don't care that you remember about antepartum.
That 1% that you were talking about, is that, how does that correlate to the amount of kids that, in a lot of countries they're giving moms a little to-go package, like a little makeshift bassinet and then kind of a starter kit to have babies. So have they looked into why, or as to whether or not that reduces the incidence of kids needing resuscitation,
yeah,
or we're talking right out of the womb?
Yeah, we're talking right out of the womb in this case. All right, so just a couple things I want to talk about. When we talk about a fetus, we're talking about a in utero. So anytime we're talking about in utero, we're talking about within the womb. Preterm, as I told you the other day, is less than 37 weeks. Term, then, is 37 to 40 weeks. Post-term, as I told you the other day, is greater than 40 weeks. They can go out to 41, 42 weeks. Typically, we're not going further than that, as I told you the other day, because the placenta tends to wear down and not do a great job. The difference between a newborn, in terms of terminology, and a neonate, and an infant, newborn is a baby born within the first several hours. Neonate is any baby during the first 30 days of birth. An infant is from the time of birth up to its first birthday. That may seem like splitting hairs to you all, but that's the world they live in as far as pediatrics are concerned. So all this is, you don't need to write it down. All this is just shows what happens from a fetal development stage over the course of the three trimesters. So during the first trimester, as I told you the other day, the first 9 weeks considered to be an embryo. That is the budding, the starting to do this budding type thing. This blast that we talked about the other day, this budding type thing that you can start to see eyes, you can start to see hands, you can start to see legs that are formed right here. Big old head. And so one of the first things that happen is development of the brain, development of the head. And so you get this big old head if you look under this huge microscope type thing. At least at 2 months gestational age, it's about 8 weeks or so, the baby's the size of a kidney bean. It's considered, it's constantly moving with distinct and slightly webbed fingers. And so these webbed fingers continue to be that way until about 13 to 14, 15 weeks gestational age, and then they start separating at that point. So just the start of the second trimester. At 3 months, the baby is 3 inches long, weighs about an ounce, and has unique fingerprints in place already. You don't need to, just some general notes in terms of what's going on with the first trimester versus second versus third. So you don't need to write it all down, unless you want to. Second trimester, at four months, 16 to 20 weeks or so, gestational age, is about 5 inches long, weighs about 5 ounces. Still too small to live outside of the utero. Even with the best of medicine, still too small to live outside of the utero. Has a skeleton that is starting to harden from rubber cartilage to bone. So the interesting thing about this is, the spine is developed about this time. So what might be one of those things that develops as the congenital problem with the spine? Lower part of the spine. Spina bifida, right? And so this big old growth at the bottom of the spine. I'll show you a picture here in just a couple minutes about that. The idea in terms of congenital problems, again, first trimester primarily into the second trimester of the fetal movement is first felt, is usually described as a flicker, 16 weeks, give or take. Heartbeat can be heard with a Doppler about this time.
And the Doppler can either be a stethoscope that is kind of oriented towards OB, or it can actually be this machine type thing that you're measuring it with. Alveoli starts developing the lungs, although the lungs are not doing anything. The lungs are silent during the entire 40 weeks. So while the alveoli will develop and everything will develop in place, it's not going to be used right now. 5 months, 20 to 24 weeks, gestational age. 8 to 10 inches long, weighs about a pound, has some hair, some very, very fine hair. Not hair that you would describe as being something that you would live with, but very, very fine hair. Remember the other day I told you about Lanugo. Lanugo is that cheesy covering, because they're laying in this in embryonic fluid, cheesy covering to protect the skin. By the way, just a side note, I forgot to mention the other day, Lanugo, not Lanugo on kids, but Lanugo, the chemical side of it, is produced in terms of lubricant for hands. Great, great hand thing in terms of softening up hands. Same type of composition that ends up on this kid in terms of pre-term. Internal organs are maturing at this point. Eyebrows, eyelids, and eyelashes appear. Not only do they appear, but the eyelids start opening about 22, 23 weeks gestational age or so. And like I showed the other day, it gives you a clue in terms of, if their eyelids are not fused, it gives you a clue in terms of the possibility of trying to resuscitate these kids. The smallest kid that I've worked on that actually survived was right about in here. 24 weeks, was just under a pound, slightly under a pound, and did not stay at our place, but we shipped them to a level 3. And so the idea in terms of how much care that it takes, how much resuscitation that it takes in terms of these kids is one thing. The rest of the story is from a developmental standpoint. Any child that's born under 26 weeks gestational age, you can almost guarantee a lifelong developmental issue going on. I have a great niece that was born in 26 weeks. She's now 7 or 8 years old. And I will tell you that from day one through her life right now, every single day is a huge challenge in terms of modeling her. So it's pretty crazy, not only in terms of they're born at this age, but what happens from a lifetime. So we're starting to get into something that is more reasonable, and that's 24 to 28 weeks, 6 months or so. Baby is 11 to 14 inches in length and weighs upwards of a pound or two. Skin is covered with vernix, okay? And that vernix, again, is part of the covering for the skin. Is able to hiccup, is starting to form baby fat. So why does this matter right here? And it does matter, by the way.
So that's the way we have it
done. Absolutely. Wow. How? You're right. There you go. Not only energy, but about thermoregulation. So kids in utero, and especially for the first couple out of utero, they depend on their baby fat to survive in terms of thermoregulation. So all the 4 or 5 different things that we've talked about in terms of thermoregulation is paramount here. And so out of that, this doesn't happen until about 24, 28 weeks. So that means those kids that are born 25, 26 weeks or so are right in that zone and not being able to regulate their own. Third trimester. So the cool thing about third trimester is most of the fetal development, although all the organs are in place, the eyes are in place, the ears are in place, everything else in place, now it just grows in terms of size. And that the greatest share of that takes place right here in the third trimester. Greatest amount of weight gained by mom. Greatest amount of complications also, not in terms of congenital, but greatest amount of complications in terms of things that can happen. As it becomes tighter space within that utero. At 7 months, which is about 28 to 32 weeks, give or take, baby is 14 to 16 inches in length, weighs 2 to 3 pounds. Taste buds have developed, fat layers are forming, again, for thermoregulation by ear. Organs continue to mature, skin is wrinkled and red, can open and close their eyes, and surfactant is formed. Prior to this, right around 28 weeks or so, I was telling you about this the other day, prior to this, surfactant has not been released from the lungs. That means there's no maturity going out of the lungs. That means these kids are going to come out and they may scream for a little bit, but there's no reserve there in terms of atelectasis, and it only gets worse. They go into respiratory distress, and these kids end up getting intubated on a ventilator for an extended period of time.
32-36 weeks. About 16 inches in length, weighs somewhere around 4 to 6 pounds. Tremendous brain growth is taking place during this time. More body organs are not developed. Lungs start to mature. Although at 33, 34 weeks, they're still immature, but they're getting to the point of where they can live out of utero. Kidneys are now mature. Skin is less wrinkled. Fingernails, and moms or dads, if you've ever seen your newborn, you know they come out with these nasty little fingernails. And that's because of this. That's because they've been growing in place for an extended period of time. And finally, into the last month. Somewhere on average about 19 to 20 inches in length, 7 to 8 pounds, although maybe bigger or smaller. The lungs are not mature. Baby is fully developed, can survive extrauterine. Skin is pink and smooth, vernix is gone. Baby's presenting, parasites into the cervix for delivery. This is what I was telling you about the other day. This is the key thing in terms of the presentation, whether or not they're going to come down and head down, or they're going to be in a breach, or they're going to be in some other presentation along the way. Typically does not happen until about the 36 weeks. Again, another thing I gave you the other day about a prolapsed cord. This is the premier time that can happen if the rupture membranes. This is the premier time that you can end up having a prolapsed cord or some other issue. And they tend to be less active. So the fact the baby's not as active doing somersaults because they don't have a whole lot of space. The space has been taken up, and so they're now in place and getting ready to go through delivery. So I want to back up for just a second. I have not, in all honesty, I have not looked at your book and how it correlates to the slide. So it was totally off. I apologize for that. But primarily live by the slide for what we're talking about. Okay. All right, so let's talk a wee bit about fetal circulation. So fetal circulation is the ability of the child, the lifeline, if you will, in terms of how they survive for 9 months in utero. So it's this complex network as to what happens. And some of it is understood quite honestly, other stuff not so much. The idea in terms of the setup as it being the feeder coming from mom to the baby is what it comes down to. In this case, when we're talking about blue, we're talking about Venus. So anything that you see in terms of blue is Venus. And just a second, Charlie. Anything that you see in red is arterial. Yes?
I thought the other day you were saying that the artery was two of them in the vein that there was only one.
I hope what I said the other day was one vein and two arteries. Is that what I said?
Oh yeah. That line's going to the red one there?
Blue
or
arteries.
Blue's arteries.
Oh, sorry, correct. Thank you. All right, so the deal on this is it feeds back into placenta. Within the fetal circulatory system, there are three shunts or openings within the heart. This is the part that will get you sideways. So just bear with me, and let me get through this, and I'll come back, and I'll see if I can't recover, okay? Within the fetal circulatory system, there are three shunts or openings within the heart, which opens most of the blood to bypass the lungs. Folks, the lungs are not used in utero. There is a small amount of fetal blood that goes to the lungs, but it's not used in terms of capacity until they come down through the birth canal and they're forced out, their chest is forced out, and it causes them to take their first breath. Up until then, this is all in utero as far as fetal circulation. Okay? To bypass the lungs and supply the rest of the fetus's body with O2 from the placenta. There are two arteries and one vein within the umbilical cord, which carries oxygen-rich blood from the placenta and returns waste products back through the placenta to mom. And mom gets rid of them through her own system. So if you were to look at the top of the cord, it looks like this little smiley face. The crazy thing about it is that you would expect the arteries to be big. They're not. These are like tiny dots. The veins are actually a little bit bigger than the arteries if you tip it up and take a look at it. I wish I had a cord to show you, but I don't.
So does the vein actually
bring
in oxygenated blood and the arteries take
out? The vein will carry oxygenated blood from the placenta to the heart. The arteries will bring deoxygenated blood back to the placenta. Yes.
Okay.
So just opposite of what you would expect. Yeah.
Actually, it's like the pulmonary circulation system.
Pretty close. Yep. All right, you okay so far?
Can I ask a quick question?
Yep, come on.
Maybe I remember this wrong, but don't the lungs still, even though they're not functioning, don't they, doesn't the chest still expand and contract within the
Lumen? Nope. No need for it. There's nothing going on there. Yeah.
So, going back to the arteries and veins, and you repeat that again, the arteries?
The veins will carry oxygenated blood from placenta to heart. It crosses over and goes through the rest of the body. The arteries will bring deoxygenated blood back to placenta that mom expels her own system.
Okay.
So there's two veins, one artery.
General.
I'm saying, oh, that's what every mother and
father. Every single time I struggle with that.
Two deoxygenated, one oxygenated.
Yep.
Say again?
Two deoxygenated, two.
Yes.
Baby.
Yes.
Two mom.
Yes.
Two deoxygenated.
Yes.
One oxygenated, two baby.
Yes.
But it's what you're saying there.
All right, so check this out in terms of circulation. Comes from the placenta, goes through the umbilical vein. It goes in two different directions. There's a small portion that goes to the liver. So remember how we talked about hepatic pulmonary design? So this is part of the regulation for our blood pressure, okay? So there's a small portion that goes to the liver. The rest of it, the lion's share of it, however, goes towards the heart. There is the first opening that I was telling you about, a number of different openings, right? So this opening is about what's going to cause the umbilical, the blood from the umbilical vein to move into the inferior vena cava. So this little hole will allow this to all pull it together. Yep.
Just a clarification, the umbilical vein goes directly to the liver, or it goes to the heart and then the liver?
So it actually splices, so there's a small portion that shoots off toward the liver. The lion's share, however, is moving towards the heart via the inferior vena cava. So inferior vena cava goes to the right atrium, as you would expect. You okay so far? Yes? No? You need to know this. So, question.
Can you repeat what you just said? Can you repeat what exactly you just said?
I don't know. Probably not.
No, just the sentence that you just said.
So the inferior vena cava at this point has picked up blood from the vein, okay? It's now headed for the right atrium, okay? As you normally would expect.
Talking about the mom here.
We're talking about baby here.
Baby.
This is fetal circulation.
I thought you said that the vein goes.
Okay.
Yep.
So meanwhile, let me finish this thought right here. So I told you the small portion has for the liver, okay? What is it eventually gonna happen is the liver is gonna move that blood to the inferior vena cava by another vein all by itself. Okay, so it's outside what we're talking about already. In the right atrium, there's a number of different things that's going to happen. Okay, so let me slow the bus down. We'll talk. On the left-hand side of that slide, portion of it goes to the right ventricle. It's going to cross over directly into something that's called the foramen. It's going to cross over into something that's called the foramen oval. Okay, so it's going to go from here, bypass the pulmonary trunk as it normally would, and crosses over to this hole, foramen elbow. From there, it's going to move to the left atrium, left ventricle, aortic arch, and it's going to get pumped out to the blood. Back over the left side of the slide. There's another portion of the blood that's going to go from the right ventricle through the pulmonary trunk, as it normally would. From the pulmonary trunk, instead of going to the lungs, it's going to cross through yet another opening that's called the ductus arteriosus. Ductus arteriosus is going to take most of this and move it directly to the aortic arch. It's going to get pumped out to the body.
Is this where you'll get those septal defects?
That's what it is. Yep. So later in life, after these kids are born, all this closes up. All this transitions in terms of a normal breathing child, as you and I are. And we all went through the same process, what we're talking about. So there's yet a third thing, okay? Very, very small portion goes through the pulmonary trunk to the lungs and gets kicked out to the left atrium, left ventricle, and onto the body. So there's three different ways in terms of what happens as far as fetal circulation. The lion's share, folks, the lion's share is this right here, this ductus arteriosus that goes from the pulmonary trunk diagnosed with scoliosis, moves over to the aortic arch, and then gets kicked out at that point. Yep.
So most of it goes from the ductus to the aortic arch, but some goes down to the trunk and lower.
Yeah, no, well, so in all regards, what happens down here is that this will move to the hard brain upper limbs.
Uh-huh.
This will move down here and turn to lower limbs. Okay?
You can't make sure where the ductus arch
is. You hang on just a second, I will, yes.
And that is after it goes through mom's.
So mom circulation's already kicked this out to here.
So that stuff coming out of the pulmonary bird, the ductus too, that is now oxygenated blood. That's sliding
yes.
over to go
yep.
out.
Yep.
But it was oxygenated before the
It's oxygenated coming from mom.
Yeah.
So everything is oxygenated in this case coming from here. So this is going to kick out to the rest of the body with oxygenated blood. Deoxygenated then it's picking up and going back to a placenta.
The lungs aren't really doing anything. It's just kind of going through it.
Laying there. That's all it is. It's just a small portion is circulating.
But the baby's heart is pumping.
Baby's heart is pumping, yes.
I
don't know what I said. Well, there's three different ways. There's a small portion that goes to the lungs, but it's doing nothing. So I told you there's three different ways. What did you understand?
I have some more things.
Okay.
So there's a.
I'll go back. All right. So wait, hang on. I know it's confusing, and I know it's hard to get your heads around. I'm going to show you a video here in just a second, so we can't go along with it. All right. Yeah.
So there's a best picture I could find in the book. It's on page 23 that kind of shows some of the.
Yep.
23.
Yep.
23. Yeah.
So go ahead and get there. I'll give you a second.
You have a video of the picture.
Yep. Can I go? Which is that picture right there, that's in your book. All right, so check this out.
So we're looking at fetal circulation here. When we look at fetal circulation, you have to remember one main thing. We are not getting oxygen. The fetus is not getting oxygen from the lungs. Okay? The fetus is actually getting oxygen from the blood that comes from the placenta. In addition to that, you can remember a couple of rules that we talked about earlier. Arteries are always going away from the heart. Veins are always going towards the heart. And on these models, what you can remember is red represents oxygenated blood, blue represents deoxygenated blood. So we'll start our pathway down here. You'll notice in the placenta we have these red structures here. This red vasculature is eventually leading into the umbilical cord as the umbilical vein. Umbilical vein comes all the way up in red, carries oxygenated blood all the way through and now into the baby, or into the fetus at the navel. That umbilical vein continues all the way up and underneath the liver meets up with another vein, the inferior vena cava, which is the main vein that leads into our heart. The umbilical vein and the inferior vena cava, because they're two veins, come together and form something called the ductus venosus. The ductus venosus is the duct between two veins. That blood then comes all the way up into the right atrium. Once we're at the right atrium, we can do several things, okay? Like we have in yours and mine, in the adult heart, we can run through the normal scenario, which would be right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary trunk to the lungs, left atrium, left ventricle, and then up and up the aorta. But just remember, we're not going to the lungs to get the blood oxygenated, okay? Blood just might flow there to bring oxygenated blood to that tissue. But as we flow through, it would eventually go all the way down in purple, because we're talking about now a mixture of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood, so red and blue make purple. We have this abdominal aorta coming all the way down. You can see it split into the iliacs. This is then going to feed all the tissue all the way down here. Eventually, it comes all the way back as the umbilical arteries. there are two umbilical arteries arising from either leg. Exits the navel, and these two umbilical arteries go all the way out the umbilical cord as the blue lines carrying deoxygenated blood. Umbilical arteries are going away from the heart. That's why we call them arteries. At the placenta, we drop off carbon dioxide, pick up oxygen, and then we head back again. So the umbilical vein comes all the way up through, heads into the body, meets up at the ductus venosus, and then goes to the right side of the heart again. Now, this is where circulation, on this route, where circulation will differ in the adult model than it is in the fetal model. So what happens here is, in the scenario that I'm going to describe, we're going to bypass pulmonary circulation. So from here, we would go from the right atrium to the right ventricle, up the pulmonary trunk, and then we would go through a structure right here. This is called the ductus arteriosus. The ductus arteriosus is a duct between two arteries. The pulmonary trunk is an artery, the aorta is an artery. So the ductus arteriosus would be the duct between two arteries. Blood is bypassed the lungs, and it will then continue to go all the way down, eventually all the way up the umbilical arteries, and back out. Another route is we come all the way in, back up to the right side of the heart, is we can go from the right side of the heart immediately to the left side of the heart. And we can do that by passing through a structure called the foramen ovale. A foramen ovale is a hole, foramen, that has an oval shape to it. And this passes from the right atrium to the left atrium. You can see I'm passing the pink pipe cleaner right through here. When we go from the right atrium to the left atrium, we immediately bypass pulmonary circulation again. From there, the left atrium, to the left ventricle, up and out the aorta, and then again throughout the rest of the body, we then deliver this blood. Now, when we look at these structures in the adult heart, we can still see remnants of them. In fact, if we look at these structures, right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle, if I open up this right atrium and we look inside here, okay, we see the foramen ovale has become something called the fossa ovalis. The fossa ovalis is that scar tissue that each of us has in between the right and the left atriums in our heart. This is what closes at birth and closes off the right side of the heart from the left side. This is what gives us an oxygenated left side of the heart and a deoxygenated blood flow through the right side of the heart. The other thing we see is ductus arteriosus. The ductus arteriosus, which was the duct between two arteries, pulmonary artery and the aorta, becomes eventually the ligamentum arteriosum. It is now the ligament between two arteries. So the ligamentum arteriosum and the fossa ovalis are remnants in our adult hearts of what we once had as structures in the fetal heart.
I have two questions. He stated that there's three pathways, but when we were talking about it, it sounds like it all happens at once.
It can travel one of three pathways.
Oh, okay.
So while he went back through a second time, all he was doing was just differentiating between it. But it will take one of three pathways in terms of the way that it goes.
And then my other question is, where does the effusion happen? Where does it become, so we have oxygenated blood, where does it become deoxygenated?
As it gets in, just as it normally would, as it gets into the tissues and the cellular level and everything else like that, is where it will drop off, pick up, just like it normally would in terms of you and I.
That does happen in the lungs.
Yeah.
To
a certain degree in the lungs, but again, we're talking about lower extremities, we're talking about the brain, we're talking about upper extremities, so like
spouse. So with the ductus arteriosus, I understand that we talked about the fact that blood goes through the lungs, although the lungs aren't really doing anything.
Yeah.
If I understand correctly, the total blood volume is not going through the lungs and coming back. If the ductus arteriosus, some of it's going to the lungs, but some of it's not even going to the lungs. It's going
lion's share is going through ductus arteriosus, which is going to mean that's moving towards the aorta. So, yes.
I'm trying to wrap my head around which one of the three, or when does it go through which route?
Yeah, so in terms of percentage, okay, so if we were looking at 100%, there's about 70% or so that will move through the ductus arteriosus. So lion's share off to the aorta, okay? Smaller portions then is divided between going to the lungs versus going through the vermin down.
Is that just because it's got the biggest hole, right?
Say again?
Of course, because it's got the biggest hole.
Probably.
It's all happening simultaneously.
Probably. Yeah, it is. It's all going up at the same time.
So it's path and less resistance gets in my share.
Yep.
But that was my question. What? It sounds like you were saying there's three different pathways that it can take.
Yes.
It doesn't happen all at once, but you just said
it does happen all at once.
Okay.
It doesn't happen all at once.
Right.
Yeah.
On the ductus arteriosus, just so I'm understanding this right, the right ventricle has oxygenated blood because of the ductus venosus?
Yes.
Okay, so that's just the connection point. It's like the bypass?
Yes.
Okay.
Think about a bypass around a city. That's essentially what it is. It's a bypass around going to the lungs.
Okay. Why do they need both? Why does the baby need the foramen
OVL
and the...
So it's, I don't know from a genetic standpoint or crazy standpoint or whatever you believe standpoint, but the idea that all three systems are most efficient in terms of feeding baby would be the answer, best answer I can give you about that. I'm sure there's somebody else better about it, but that's where I'm at.
So there's fetal heartbeat at this point in the left ventricle, talking about path-based resistance, is that actually assisting baby's blood pressure, or is it actually working against it? Because path-based resistance seems like it would be backwards at that point.
So baby's blood pressure, if you were to monitor baby's blood pressure in utero, it's very, very, very small. Very small.
So the kick of the left ventricle beating, even though there's blood in it...
Doesn't exist. Frank Starling does not exist here.
Okay, so
right.
It's just a...
Does that give you relief, or what?
I'm trying to understand, on the book, it shows that the oxygenated blood comes up from that ductus venosus.
Yes, sir.
That comes into the right ventricle?
Right
atrium?
Yep.
But it's blue in the right atrium on this one, and then it turns purple.
What they're saying is it's still oxygenated blood for the most part, okay? But it starts mixing at that point with some deoxygenated blood, and so it turns, they're talking about it turning purple.
So where's the deoxygenated blood?
I know what your question is. So the idea in terms of blood coming back and bringing everything else like that, that's about the portion that starts doing. It's still carrying oxygenated blood. And so for the purposes that you don't get confused about, just remember at this point, still oxygenated blood. Yes, there is some site, deoxygenated blood that comes into.
But that's coming from the superior vena cava.
Yes.
Oxygenated
is
coming from there. So those two are
going together
in
the
right atrium.
Right. And so he was talking about it turning purple.
Yeah.
That's where it happened.
Okay. No, that's why I was just trying to understand.
Yep. No, thank you. Thanks for asking the question.
Can you go back a couple slides and just to where?
To where what?
Start over.
No, I'm going to start over.
Do the picture with all the arrows and just.
Here's what I'm going to do. It is time for a break. This is a good place to break. I'm going to leave this slide up, get what you need. That one or that one?
That one.
All right. I'm going to get what you need. When you come back, we're going to go back to reviewing it again.
I have a question.
I'm sure you do.
So after blood goes to the tissues, where does it all meet up when you go to the umbilical artery?
What does the ductus venosus do? What does it do?
That's pumped blood to the aorta.
Goes to the heart.
What does the ductus venosus do?
It splits from the umbilicus. It goes to the liver and goes to the inferior.
That's it, right there. Okay. It hooks up with the inferior vena cava. Okay. All right. So, Chris, what does the foramen ovale do?
That is the hole essentially between the right atrium and the left atrium.
Right. And so it's going to bypass the lungs based on that, yes?
Yes.
Okay. Jason Webster, tell me about the ductus arteriosus.
The ductus arteriosus connects the pulmonary artery and the aortic arch.
Yep. Yep. So again, it bypasses the lungs. Okay? What? So trust me, you will not be an expert. And you know what? I used to be fairly good at this in terms of circulation. Now I had to physically think about this, okay? So it's not a natural thing in terms of knowing the circulation, right? Do yourself a favor. Either go back and take a look at this video that I've got here, there's a number of other ones out there that will kind of explain it as well. Do yourself a favor, go back and take a look at it. Any questions along the way, I'll be glad to try to answer.
I think the confusion is coming from, it's not a bypass, it's an alternative route.
I agree with that, I guess.
When I think of bypass, I think, okay, I'm not going this way anymore, I'm only going this way.
I guess I agree with that.
I'm confused on where the oxygenated blood is coming into the left atrium, because it looks like your inferior vena cava is the one that's going to come up with the oxygenated blood. And I'm not seeing where oxygenated blood comes into the left atrium, because it shows that it's kind of deoxygenated from the lungs, but then it comes in and it's oxygenated in the left atrium, and I'm not sure where the oxygenated blood's getting to the left atrium. Mm-hmm. What valve is coming into the left atrium, or left atrium?
It's the foramen oval that will take it across that to the left side.
That's
of the
because that's the lion's share of coming from the right atrium, because that's relatively oxygenated, even though it's deoxygenated from the blood from the superior vena cava.
Yes.
Yep.
I think it's got the wrong color
in
the blood.
No, because it has to be oxygenated, because it goes from the left atrium to the left ventricle and then out with oxygenated blood to the aortic arch, right?
Yep.
Okay.
You say
70%. 70% is ductus arteriosus.
So we were talking about that it has three different routes of pain, right? So it can go from the right ventricle to the lung.
Yes.
To
the pulmonary trunk.
Oval.
Yep.
And then what's the third one?
Ductus arteriosus.
Ductus arteriosus.
So check this out. This is going to make sense in that couple different ways. Again, baby comes down through the canal, the chest is expanded, takes its first breath. Okay. Baby comes out and starts crying. All this is transitioning to a normal extra urine like you and I. Okay. So while it starts at birth, it doesn't mean that that all these bypasses, openings, will close off completely. That happens over a period of time. So newborn murmurs is this right here. That's all that is. And the reality is, anytime you're listening to a murmur, that's what's going on right here. There's some sort of opening along the way. Be that from birth, be that from what congenital problem along the way, that's part of a murmur. Does that make sense? The second way that it makes sense is this, or at least makes sense to me, is that in order for a baby to move from intrauterine to extrauterine, this has to take place. If it were just the other way, it was just like you and I in a normal breathing type of thing, this would not work. So this is the only system that will work in terms of baby survival. Okay? There is something that's called persistent fetal circulation. You don't need to know it. Persistent fetal circulation. Baby comes out. Instead of going from a normal transition to breathing and living like you and I, they persist in this fetal circulation. It's synonymous with small preemies. It's synonymous with some congenital type problems. So you can imagine they don't do well out of urine very, very long at all. Okay, so they're in major problems. And so when I start to think about that, I think about the transition that takes place at birth, and that's what we'll talk about as well.
How do they fix that?
Persistent fetal circulation is about medications. Murmurs, usually they will follow along depending on what's going on with them and everything else like that.
Before we move on, I'm just trying to picture in my head where it gets to the ductus arteriosus. Does it go through the foramen oval and then up and out?
No. So foramen oval will take a portion of that blood directly. Mm-hmm. The arteriosus is starting to move toward the pulmonary trunk and then instead go to the aorta.
Okay. So it goes down to the trunk, and then?
And then, instead of going to the lungs, it still will move towards the aorta at that point. Can I go?
You said that comes out of deep right?
Ductus arteriosus will transition to the pulmonary trunk to the aorta.
Right. You said that does not go through the foramen ova?
No.
That would make sense.
So there's an opening, again, small. There's an amount of blood that will move through that, okay? There's an amount of blood that will continue on to the right atrium and then shoot off to the ductus arteriosus. And there's a third portion that works through the lungs.
There's something between the right atrium and the aorta. Mm-hmm.
That's what the ductus arteriosus is. The
connection between the right atrium and the aorta.
Mm-hmm. That's what ductus arteriosus is. Right
ventricle.
All right, we gotta go, folks. We gotta go. We're not gonna solve all your issues right now. But the idea in terms of going back, you gotta do your part here in terms of looking at it. Okay? If it's still confusing to you, I'll be glad to get with you one on one. Is that fair enough? What?
Can I clarify that? You said it's from the right atrium.
What I said is that it will start into the right atrium. As it gets to the pulmonary trunk, instead of going through the lungs, that ductus arteriosus will take it directly through the aorta at that point.
Okay, so it still goes to the left atrium.
Yeah. No. 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 Get with me afterwards. I'll take care. All right, we gotta go. Newborn heart rate is the most sensitive indicator in evaluating physiological distress. While you and I and our body can adjust stroke volume, these kids can't. They're dependent on a placenta to give a regular stroke volume along the way. So the only thing that's going to work for them is heart rate. Hence the idea that when kids get into fetal distress, as in they're in utero and their heart rate of 120 to 180 all of a sudden drops to 60, how well are they to be able to move blood throughout their system? This is why kids in utero are so sick, based on simple things about a heart rate. Right? Bradycardia is caused by hypoxia. Hypoxia is a result of poor respiratory circulation. The most significant physiological change required in the newborn occurs during transition from the intrauterine to extrauterine. So in utero, born, during this transition, the cardiovascular respiratory system transitions from a placenta-dependent fetal circulation to the autonomous first breath and self-support system, where everything switches. As the infant's chest emerges from the vagina, the squeezing happens causes the newborn's metabolic system to begin to change from maternal support to self-support by pushing some of the amniotic fluid out of the nose and mouth. This in turn prepares the lungs for first breath. That sudden breath, that gushing type thing, is what starts the transition.
They want
babies, right? Yep, exactly what they want to try. Outside of well-being. So here's your thing. Think about this just a wee bit further. Who would be, with this in mind, who would not do well in terms of this right here? C-section for what reason?
Because there was no squeezing.
They don't get the squeeze, right? Who else?
It's
I've seen a pound and a half, 2 pound kids that will slip down from the birth canal, absolutely no pushing whatsoever, none. Whoop, like a slide. And so there's no squeezing there as well. So either way, you can have some kids that are in respiratory distress just based on this right here. All right, so there's some chemical sides of this as well. Decreased O2 levels in hemoglobin will create increased levels of CO2 and decreased pH. That sounds an awful lot like what?
Metabolic
acidosis, very good. Stimulates the respiratory center and the medulla. Thermal factor, as the fetus enters a colder environment, i.e. nice and warm, toasty inside and everything else like that, about 99 degrees, give or take, they come out and it's colder than an Arctic circle, okay? That is yet another reason that caused them to take their first breath. However, they do not do well after that, okay? So thermoregulation is a good first move, but after that thermoregulation is one of the bigger problems. They depend on their, what the so-called brown fats, the fats they live on in utero. During the first breath, air enters the upper airway to replace the lost fluid during the recoil of the thorax, which clears the amniotic fluid, which is good. Meconium stain, however, bad. So they've been living in poop-filled fluids for the last how many months. The idea that they're going to now start to breathe that in to the lungs is an aspiration waiting to happen. That's when you step in and do your heroics. We'll talk about that. Oxygen-enriched air rapidly rushes into the alveoli, further displacing the fluid and inflating the sacs. So alveoli are now starting to do their job finally after all these months. The chemical substance that we've been talking about, surfactant, is produced, and surfactant is already there. Surfactant is already on board, assuming that they're new, or assuming that they're mature ones, okay? Pre-cure, not so much. In which the alveoli reinflates after that because of that surfactant being released. So what I've already told you, the idea in terms of surfactant not being available with preterm is one of the reasons they end up in respiratory distress, one of the reasons they end up on ventilators, and one of the reasons they end up with a whole lifelong respiratory problem because of this right here. All right, let me push this just a wee bit further. Circulatory transition takes place. As the infant begins to breathe more and more air, pulmonary arterioles start to dilate, allowing more oxygen to enter the pulmonary bloodstream. As the placenta flow stops, and that's the other thing about it, the flow from the placenta is now done. There is an increase in systemic vascular resistance and a decrease in the pulmonary vascular resistance, reducing the pulmonary arterial, right ventricle, and right arterial pressures, which in turn stimulates the closure of the three ducts. So it's a combination of different things. Well, it's about chemical. It's about a pulmonary system that's transitioning. It's about coming out into a cold environment. It's about a number of different things that creates all this. All right, so you don't need to know each and every one of these things, but a lot of them we've already talked about. What are some risk factors that will create issues for neonates as they're born? Well, certainly age differences, the idea of the young gals, the idea of the so-called older gals, greater than 35 years of age, now that they're old. The idea in terms of estimated date of confinement, premature or post, so anything less than 37 weeks, anything greater than 42 weeks, are a sign that you might need to be thinking about neonatal resuscitation. Toxemia. Toxemia is about maternal hypertension, preeclampsia, eclampsia. Third trimester, diabetes, we talked about in the same breath, all together as far as predicting when you might need to do resuscitation. So polyhydramnios and oligohydramnios is about fluids within the sac, okay? Too little or too much is a problem. Not that you're going to be experts in terms of the amount of fluid that should be lost, but the idea that when kids have certain issues with their renal system or certain digestive issues, it's going to result in either too little or too much amount of fluid as far as it goes. You and I are not going to know that in a pre-hospital side. We're not going to have a clue about that unless there's some sort of a history that the mom can tell you about. We talked the other day about premature rupture of membranes. That is that membrane's ruptured, there's no labor going on, and then she's been sitting there for 12 to 24 hours, and I told you about sepsis as being one of the problems out of that. On the right-hand side, the other day, we talked about the danger of no prenatal care. We talked about her past medical history concerning OB. So was she a high risk before? If so, for what reason? Drugs and alcohol, we talked about. Smoking, we talked about. Fetal anemia, we talked a little bit about. That is, if mom is anemic going into this birth, then baby can suffer because of that. We talked the other day about mom with sexually transmitted disease, gonorrhea being the big deal. That will create issues for baby coming down to the birth canal. And by the way, these moms that end up having gonorrhea during pregnancy, they'll take the baby by cesarean section. So couples that have infertility issues is going to be a high risk, in part because of perhaps multiple gestation, but also in part because of risk factors that go along with the drugs they're taking for infertility. If mom has had a recent infection just prior to delivery, the kid is susceptible to being at risk for resuscitation secondary to sepsis. So continuing on, interpartum, that is while mom is getting ready to come into the world. Again, we talked about premature rupture of membranes. Abnormal presentation, we talked about the other day. So breech or transverse or something like that. We talked the other day about prolapsed cord. So chorio amniosis, do not worry about. That's just something we do with the amniotic fluid. Excuse me. Meconium stain fluid, yep, in a big way. Use of narcotics within 4 hours of delivery. I talked to you the other day about this, the idea that if we end up giving narcotics just prior to birth, we can almost guarantee we're going to have a depressed baby that we're now dealing with. While it may take some of the pain away from mom, it doesn't do so well for a baby because it crosses placental barrier. We talked the other day about previa and abruptio. Prolonged or precipitous delivery. So prolonged is in they've been in labor for days and days and days and days. Precipitous delivery is just the opposite, where the baby comes shooting out, if you will, and they can be both ways. Moms that are up on meth, moms that are up on cocaine, are famous for precipitous deliveries. Bleeding from mom in terms of anything that's going to be passed on to baby. Nuchal cord, anytime we talk about nuchal cord, we're talking about placenta cord, okay? We're talking about a neck cord. Anytime you see nuchal, it's about neck. So neck cord around the neck, or a true knot to where it's truly in the knot. And then we talked about already as to why fetal bradycardia is such a big deal as far as not being able to adjust anything, the stroke volume is consistent. Any questions on these? So again, I think we kind of hammered on this the other day, so I'm not going to hang out here. We want to know about length of pregnancy. When does she do? We want to know about her contractions. We want to know about whether or not baby has been moving, although that is not as key as some of the other things we're talking about here. We want to know about whether or not her membranes are intact and when they ruptured and what was the color of them. We want to know about her medication. We want to know about her history, all those things that we touched on the other day. So started to talk about the delivery of not only taking care of mom, but baby as well. So I told you the other day that you can't possibly have enough warm blankets, warm dry blankets, a bulb syringe that should come in that measly little OB kit that you're opening up, clamps that come with that, a pair of scissors that's part of that as well, and if at all possible, getting a beanie cap for the head. These newborns will end up losing about a third of their body heat through their head source. And so the more you can dry the head, the more you can get it covered, the better off they're going to be in terms of thermal regulation. So we talked about this the other day, and all they're talking about is the prolapsed cord. And so the idea is that the reasons as to why you have prolapsed cord along the way is what they're talking about. And hopefully you got that the other day. So let's start with the normal first. 2% of infants born with congenital problems, okay? And so, again, that first trimester is typically when that's going to show up, and it can be in a whole number of different things. And we're not going to, we could spend hours in talking about some of those congenital problems that are out there. Kieran was talking about his sister and some things that she went through. There's a whole host of them out there, and I don't think it's going to gain you a whole lot in terms of telling you about things you're going to forget it about 30 seconds. And so I'm not going to do it. Congenital problems arise from problem in fetal development. Most fetal development occurs during first trimester pregnancy. Many types of congenital abnormalities. So there's three that's here that I'll touch on briefly. Diaphragmatic hernia, anybody know what that is?
Hernia.
Yep. And? You're halfway there. And? you know, definitely an inability to breathe.
The lungs push it down through the hole in the back.
Just the opposite. So the bowel loop is pushed up into the lung. Okay? So diaphragmatic hernia is about a general defect. It is getting, and remember we talked about it in trauma, with chest trauma. You could have it with a major trauma going on, but in this case, it is a general problem. They're born that way. So a loop of the bowel is into the lung. How's that gonna create problems? Sepsis will be one, bowel obstruction is another, and they can't breathe as being the third. So literally what they'll end up doing is they'll go in and they'll open up at that area and they'll take a portion of the bowel, they'll cut it because it's ischemic at that point or necrotic at that point. So they'll just cut it, they'll reanimate the most the bowel together and repair the diaphragm. So it's kind of a big deal. So this meningomyocele is a spinal cord associated structures exposed, so it's along the lines of a spina bifida. Omphysio is a defect in the area of the belly. Okay, take a look. This is an omphysio to where contents are born with these contents outside the belly, and that's going to create problems both in breathing and the possibility of sepsis as well. This is a spina bifida, and so they're born with this defect in the lower portion of the back. Typically, these kids are paralyzed from the waist down.
That top picture.
Yep.
Is that in the umbilical cord or
where? It could be anywhere. So you see penis here. The idea this happens to be the umbilical cord, but it can be anywhere. It could be right upper or lower or anything else along the way. We're not going to talk about corneal atresia, cleft palate. You have probably seen it before and maybe know somebody with them. Cleft palate is an issue in terms of airway. And so sometimes that cleft palate can be the entire palate. Other times it's not quite so much. But it's going to create issues as far as airway need to do anything further. Not always, but kids with Down syndrome are susceptible for cleft palates. So out of that, what do you do now? The head delivered, and going back to a normal delivery. As the head is delivered, check for a nuchal cord. We talked about this the other day. Slip it or clamp it and cut it. As the baby's head is delivered, lower the body. And again, they're going to rotate, as we talked about the other day. They're going to rotate to one side or the other. And so you're going to lower and then bring the body back up again. And as we get to labs, we'll demonstrate that. If baby is healthy, skin-to-skin contact with mom, dry him, and perhaps need to suction a little bit, but get him onto mom's belly as soon as possible. So it isn't like your assessment is done all by itself, but the idea that you're doing a number of different things, just like you normally would. When you go into somebody's house and you're doing an assessment, you're doing a lot of other things along the way, right? Well, this is no different in terms of you doing your assessment as you're doing a number of other things in terms of taking care of business. This is a busy scene. If you're the sole paramedic, you're kind of watching over your shoulder to see what's going on with mom, and also what's going on with the newborn. If at all possible, note the time of delivery, monitor the ABCs, respiratory rate, respiratory effort, pulse rate, color, and capillary refill. In many cases, they will come out and they will do very, very well, especially for the first 5 or 10 minutes. And so you're just keeping your eye in terms of the possibility of respiratory distress. And this is kind of a drum we've been beating all week long, but 90% of these kids do very, very well. They could do it in anybody's home, no big deal at all. Position the baby to ensure a patent airway. So the idea in terms of getting them face down, and just like they've got here, I like to have them lean up against the arm, and that way you can control as to where you're going with them. And so getting them down into a head down position works with gravity as far as getting rid of any secretions on board. Clear the airway with a ball syringe as you need to, assessing the baby's color. So initial questions to consider, is the newborn clear of meconium? If you know going into this woman delivered that she has meconium or there's meconium in amniotic fluid, it's going to be set up for you in terms of needing a resuscitation. That's one of the key indicators that you need to get your equipment lined up and get ready to resuscitate this kid. And again, 80% of the time, 90% of the time, these kids will come out even with meconium on board and do well. If the other 10-20% would be probably poor. Does a newborn come out breathing and crying? Does a newborn have good muscle tone? Is the skin pink? Is the baby consistent with term gestation? This child right here has got this cheesy film that I was telling you about. That's the reason I threw it in. That's a cheesy film that I was telling you about that probably shows this kid is being less than term. And that's what you'll see. Doesn't this look a whole lot like APGAR? Essentially what they're taking you through is APGAR. If baby is crying and active on the left-hand side, continue to dry and suction, keep the infant warm, wrap them in a blanket, get rid of any wet blankets, and continue to wrap and dry. Assign an APGAR score, and we'll get into that here in just a second. On the right-hand side, the baby is crying or limp, you rub the back or flick the feet. Low by oxygen, continue to stimulate and oxygen, assign an APGAR score. So let's do that. I'll shut my mouth, I'll let you write, and then we'll talk. So APGAR comes from Dr. Virginia APGAR that developed this back in 1950 sometime, so it's been in place for a long, long time. It's the key assessment, if you will, in terms of the first 5 to 10 minutes of whether or not the child is doing well. So kind of a well-being, a quick, down and dirty well-being. So starting on the left-hand side here, we're going to talk about appearance or color. We're going to talk about pulse. We're going to talk about grimace and what that is. We're talking about activity, muscle tone, and then finally we're talking about respiratory effort. Now check this out. You can get 0, you can get a 1, or you can get a 2. It's kind of like GCS just in a way, okay? So let's talk about appearance or color. Kids that come out completely pink at 1 minute, and we measure this at 1 minute, we measure this at 5 minutes. So 1 minute, 5 minutes. Starting with color. Kids can come out completely pink. They can come out that their trunk, their chest, their abdomen, their back is pink. However, their limbs are blue. And a 0, you get a 0 if everything's blue. If they're cyanotic throughout the body and cyanotic throughout the limbs. So we're talking about a pulse. A 0, obviously, if there's no pulse. A 1 is if it's greater than 100. And a 2 is if it's less than, one is less than 100, 2 is greater than 100, thank you. Grimace. So the idea in terms of grimace is if the child comes out spontaneously crying and is carrying on or things like that, they automatically get a 2. If they come out and they look like Scrooge on Christmas morning, the idea if they come out with kind of that facial thing would be a 1, and they do absolutely nothing but just lay there dormant, and then they get a 0. Muscle tone or activity. If they come out and they're just laying there limp and not moving, kind of like a painful stimuli, if you will, there's nothing going on at all, that's a 0. If they come out moving some arms and legs and some startling and everything else like that, that's worth a 1. And a 2 would be active motion. And finally, respiratory effort. If they come out, they're doing absolutely nothing in terms of breathing, it's a 0. If they come out and they're doing a slow, irregular type breathing, that's worth a 1. If they come out with a strong cry with greater than respiratory rate of 30 per minute, that's worth a 2. Now here's what I'm going to tell you. The normal Apgar at 1 minute typically will be somewhere around 7 to 8. And by that, rarely do kids come out that they're going to be completely pink in terms of this. So this is something that's called acrocyanosis. And all that is cyanosis of the hands, the feet, and that type of thing. Blood hasn't quite got there yet. And so it's going to take a while for that to start to happen. So in many medications, you're going to end up assigning a 1 for color or appearance. Pulse is either it is or it's not. Okay? Rarely will they come out and they're going to have a pulse less than 100. But if they do, then you assign it that way. So typically, these kids come out healthy, and you're going to automatically give them a 2 based on where they're at with their pulse.
60
is the cutoff for resuscitation, but that doesn't have anything to do with Apgar per se. Yep. So to that then, go down to the very bottom, respiratory effort. You're either going to come out breathing or not, and so that's fairly easy. The 2 that will sometimes get you is about grippus and activity. And if you think about that in terms of whether or not the child is moving and kind of doing something along the way, it gives you a clue about grippus and activity. Yes. Yep. So this is about the sparrow reflex, and this is one of the things I was telling you about in terms of muscle tone. Take a look.
Now the last thing I
want to
talk about is with our little friend who doesn't like me anymore, and I don't blame her. I'm going to check what reflex.
You see how they will wrap their thumbs around your hand? That's a normal reflex. That's part of what they should be doing. Same thing with their feet. Babinski, they should be wrapping their toes around your fingers.
And she's showing us what we call traction reflex. She's flexing her arms. And then the last thing I'm going to do is the so-called moral or startle reflex. So I need to make her startle a little bit. And I do that by pulling the arms out, but I never pull the head off the table. Okay? I don't want her to clunk her head on the table. So we go like this, and I let go suddenly.
That's a startle reflex. That's a normal reflex in terms of hands and legs coming up. So back, yeah, I know. Back to this, in terms of muscle tone, startle reflex would be a way to get there. But if you got this kid that's coming out and doing this kind of thing, flailing, everything like that, you don't need to do that. The idea there's any doubt in your mind, that's the way to get there. Does that make sense?
What? Yes, try that.
Yeah, exactly. But again, you know, I, in all honesty, there was times where I would do that just to get them crying again, just to clear whatever was done. You heard the junkiness in their lungs, and just get them to cry to clear that. All right.
Did you say what was normal at 5 minutes?
At 5 minutes, typically an Apgar of 8 to 9 would be normal. So speaking of, let's kind of break this down a little bit.
So did you say, I'm sorry, I didn't catch the 1 minute fold.
7 to 8. Yeah. So anything above 7, folks, is you're an okay ground. Okay? So a 7 to 8 at 1 minute is kind of like a GCS of 13 to 14. Okay? Doing relatively well, you keep your eye on everything else like that. Okay? 5 minutes should generally improve. So at 1 minute might be one thing. 5 minutes should not be going in the opposite direction. If it is, then you've got a bigger problem. All right, does that make sense? It's kind of like a GCS, if you're tracking a GCS. Provides a baseline of assessment at 1 to 5 minutes, gives you an idea of how aggressive that you need to be in terms of managing this kid. Okay? So if you have a lousy Apgar, you need to be thinking about getting on with what you need to do for neonatal resuscitation, which is where we're going next. It's valuable in terms of getting passed on because they will ask about Apgar score in LED unit or newborn unit. And here's this. 7 to 10 is minimal resuscitation needed. 4 to 7 is moderate. Below 4 is aggressive. So again, I kind of think about this as being a GCS. GCS lesson 7 to 8, I know about, you know you're going to have to get on your haunches in terms of taking care of them, right? And this is kind of the same way as far as determining how much and how what you need to do in the lights up. Does that make sense? I mentioned this already, but this acrocyanosis, cyanosis in the limbs and the feet, that type of thing, very, very common that it would come out and be blue about that. That's completely normal for them. So there's a couple of slides here. I don't want you to get wrapped around the idea that you have to use pulse oximetry on these kids. All these slides we're talking about is that pulse oximetry will show us if you're doing pulse oximetry right at birth, 30 seconds after the born, it's going to be like way down low. It's going to be here because they're transitioning still into a regular respiratory system. And then over a period of time, it will start trending towards a normal. Okay? So again, don't get wrapped around this in the next couple of slides. A blood pressure at birth is somewhere between 60 and 90 systolic, and that's quite a range, but it's all completely normal.
Are you getting that through palpation? Because I can't see trying to get a blood pressure.
A Doppler. They can do it through a Doppler, yeah.
I mean, if we're doing it in the field, though, is there a...
You won't be able to do it in the field.
If you palpate brachial, is that a certain...
Good luck with that one.
Okay.
I've never been able to
do it. Basically, your SOL, smile and nod.
Yeah. So you're gonna have a lot of other ways of evaluating other than this right here for a new one. All right, so temperature, I've talked about this before, but the idea, one of the best things you can do, if you wanna see a labor delivery nurse smile at you instead of frown at you, this is it right here. Bring a warm child to that unit and they're not gonna chew on you. They're liable to chew on you if they end up bringing a bradycardic cold baby to them, okay?
Yeah,
is the temporal thermometer accurate with these guys?
Somewhat. That's not great, but somewhat. And that goes back to what I was talking about with the pulse oximetry. And I'm just gonna slide out. All this talks about is that over a period of time, it will start going from this 40 to where they live in utero and start shooting up in terms of normal. And you can see in right about 5 minutes or so is when that starts to take place. All right, so in terms of heart rate, the normal heart rate for a newborn is somewhere between 120 and 160, 180, and right at birth, it's completely normal. So while that's going to be SVT in any other world along the way, SVT for newborns is not to where you get to 220. 220 and above is considered SVT in newborn. Okay, so here, they live in this world, and they're still transitioning in terms of getting to a rate that you and I can identify with. On the flip side of that, a pulse rate below 100 is not good news for newborns. A pulse rate below 60 is reason for CPR. And not coming up with ventilations with the other qualifier we talked about the other day. Normal respiratory rate in these kids is somewhere between, I know the slide says 40 and 60, normal respiratory rate is between 30 and 60. All right, any questions on normal birth? Yeah, go ahead, Charlie.
So, you talked about doing the compressions to get their heart rate up over 60.
Yeah.
Are we doing it for 2 minutes of chest compressions?
Let me get there, I'll answer your question. Okay. The answer is yes. So hang with preemies for just a wee bit. Presentations of preemies are challenging. You have to be thinking, you have to be doing a lot of different things along the way. Right? So the key things you're looking for is obviously cyanosis. You can do something about that, right? Oxygen, lethargy, ultra level of consciousness. You can do something about that in terms of stimulating them. Hypothermia, keeping them warm. You can do something about that. Bradycardia. So if we're talking about bradycardia because of responses to the other thing, you can do something about that. Stimulating them 9 times out of 10 will increase that heart rate. Hypotension is then about cardiac output. If you can increase the bradycardia, you can do something with the heart rate, or excuse me, with the blood pressure. Does that make sense? So it's all tied in together. These are all things that you can do something about. So suction is indicated when obstruction to the spontaneous breathing requires positive pressure ventilation. That is, if a child comes out and they're all gurgling with a lot of fluid stuff and not fluid through the mouth, the idea that we're going to suction those out so they can start breathing, obviously. And to that if you have to start bagging somebody, you have to start bagging this newborn, you want to do a little bit of suction prior to that, so you're not pushing anything into the lungs. Having to do vigorous suctioning no longer is. It used to be that we were doing this all the time, but it has really been minimized in terms of the amount of suction that we're doing along the way. The kicker is going to be about meconium, and we're going to walk through that in terms of how to treat those kids, and we're going to be working on that in terms of your lab skills and what's up, so don't freak just quite yet.
We are going to be positive.
Yeah.
At the end of it.
Yep.
So are we just not going to be doing a lot of stimulation if we see the meconium or smell meconium because we don't want them?
So again, Charlie, I hate to put you off to your question, but the answer is we're not going to be stimulating at all, but we'll come and we'll talk about that. Okay.
Are we using any drugs?
Very little.
When we intubate
them? No. If they're not sick, but you're intubating them, they're generally not going to have a gathering class. I can think on one hand the number of times that we had to RSI kids because of airway issues. So it usually doesn't exist.
Should we have to suction them? I can't remember. Is it mouth first, then nose, or does it matter anymore?
They doesn't matter. Okay. They talked about nose and then mouth, but.
Okay.
All right. So let's go into this world a little bit. Talk about this. Algorithm developed by the American Academy of Pediatrics. So this is kind of like the AHA, if you will, in terms of newborns. They're newborns. These are the gurus for it. Defining the intervention, the assessment, and the determination of newborns. So all this talks about, you don't need to know this per se, but all this talks about is the type of equipment that you would end up having in a typical neonatal resuscitation. So I'll just draw your attention to a couple of different things. Number one, up here is something that's called a meconium aspirator. That's what you're going to be using in terms of learning to suction meconium out of the airway. You're going to be intubating, and you're going to be attached to this meconium aspirator, and you're going to be suctioning that meconium out that's in the lungs. On the left-hand side, 3.5 sterile feeding tube, umbilical, catheterization. So in NICUs, what they end up doing is umbilical cord at birth is cut. You put an umbilical clamp on it, right? So what they do when we're going to take care of setting up an umbilical catheter or artery catheter is we will go in and we'll cut that clamp off. You get a hold of the stump of the umbilical cord. And again, you can see the dots in terms of venous versus artery. So what they end up doing is they take one of these catheters and they just feed it down through there. And either you're going to get a venous line or you're going to get an arterial line. Now the difference being that usually in NICUs, they set up an arterial line. That way they can do all their drugs, their blood gases, push their drugs, and the like stuff is one easy way of doing that. From a pre-hospital standpoint, if you're flying with LifeFlight, the idea of they will set up an umbilical venous catheter, the difference being, okay? What we're going to show you in the days to come is if you could do it with a little 20-gauge needle through the umbilical vein. We'll show you ways to do it.
The vein, right?
Yeah, vein.
Why would you
want to
do an arterial? The part that doesn't make sense to me is that you've got the cord, that's coming out of the intestine.
Yeah, but you're thinking in utero. Remember now that it's all flipped? Instead of coming out, the idea of that is now supplying blood supply or oxygen supply. Okay. You're dealing with the problems, I know. All right, so let me take us a couple of places. Down into the right-hand corner there. Brazos tape is a must. It's a need. We need it. I do okay with this stuff, but I would have to tell you that if I had to work on a 3-pound kid these days, Brazos would be my friend. Okay? It should be yours as well. Epinephrine, atropine, Narcan, and D10. You should know that we do not use D50, we don't use D25 in newborns. D10 is a drug of choice for hypoglycemia. And we'll talk about those doses.
We drink better, so.
Yeah. left-hand side. Our typical, if we're gonna intubate, the typical type thing we're using is a straight blade, either a zero or a one. And it's even a zero zero for string preemies. Your typical type typical type ET tube you're gonna use, depending on the size of the newborn, is anywhere from a 2.0 up to about a 4 or 4.5 with a regular size newborn. Uncuffed. Not cuffed, uncuffed. So check this out, back over to the medication side. Do you see a long, long, long list of medications there? So the reality is this, and I'll show you a different slide that will kind of get this. But the reality is this. There's one drug you use in EMA resuscitation. What is it? There's epi. And, oh, by the way, there's epi. And did I mention there's epi? Because the idea is these kids have young, healthy hearts, 99% of the time, young, healthy hearts. They don't need a whole lot of other stuff, okay? So epinephrine is the drug of choice in EMA resuscitation. Have I seen them go deep into some other drugs? Oh, yeah. But the idea in a typical term resuscitation, the good news for you is there's epinephrine.
So you have naloxone in there, that's the Narcan, right?
Yes.
Is that if the mom was...
it's indicated that the mom has been doing stuff?
Either because we gave narcotics too close to delivery, or that we believe that mom is hooked up on drugs. And I'll talk about that as a separate thing, because that's got some challenges to it as well, especially these days. So a couple things about that. While D25 is not the best way to go with newborns, you can do it with D25, and you can mix up D25 fairly easy. There's a way of mixing up D10 as well. I'll kind of share that with you. And you're right. It's not like we carry D10 all over the place. So in terms of baggage kits, self-inflating bag with an oxygen reservoir. So what we're talking about is our typical type BBM with a reservoir on the back. Okay? So the kicker is this. Have you ever heard those pop-up valves on the child BBMs and the infant BBMs where it pops off at a certain level? They're designed for what? Why are they there? So supposedly we don't create pneumothorax, okay? Check this out. For the first couple of breaths, when you're in resuscitation, for the first couple of breaths, you do not want to engage that pop-off valve because they need a fair amount of pressure in terms of opening them up and ventilating along the way. Okay? And I know that sounds counterintuitive to what you expect. It doesn't mean that you just gush it in and then stop on it. It just means that you probably are going to need to give them a greater amount to see chest rise. Does that make sense?
So you take that pop-off off?
For the first couple of breaths.
You bang slow?
We'll talk about that. So there are other ones that they end up using in hospital in NICU units, and that is they use something that's called an anesthesia bag, and they just have a manometer attached to it so they can know exactly how much that they're inflating, and then naturally these kids go under a ventilator at that point. If you haven't noticed, there's towels and blankets everywhere throughout the slide presentation. That's part of you. All right, so you need to know this. What's your right number? Aspects as we get into peds next week, but for right now, for this. No. All right, so when they say inverted, folks, inverted resuscitation is just the opposite of what you do with adults, right? So for an adult, you come in, you do circulation and airway breathing. And so you get right into CPR and the lights off, you get the oxygen hooked up and everything else like that. What they're saying here is that about 99.9% of your issues can be taken care of right here. If you get as far as chest compressions, that is going to take care of about 99% of your issues. So inverted in the sense that you're rarely going to get into intubation, inverted in the sense that you're rarely going to get into medications, okay? I will tell you this, that you do not need to be in a huge hurry to intubate newborns. How many times do you suppose you will do it in your lifetime? Hopefully, right? So the idea, how good are you going to be at it?
Not very.
Probably not, right? So what can you do then? How are you going to survive? Yeah, but let me make it even simpler for you.
Impressions.
Let me make it even simpler for you. I literally bagged infants for hours at a time with no ET tube in place. Good OPA, good BVM type ventilations, okay? We had a power outage where I worked, and we were without trying to ventilate these kids with ET tube, okay? So the idea in terms of bagging them, you can do it very, very successfully with good basic hand technique.
Well,
they're
gonna have any stomach contents, so it's going
to go. Yeah, for the most part, they're gonna have some amniotic fluids there, but for the most part, they do relatively well.
They've been breathing all that stuff in there.
Yeah.
So it's not going to really affect it.
No, unless it aspirated at birth.
So a long time back, you talked about how it's counterproductive to use CPR during transport on an adult because of size. I'm imagining with an infant, with the way that we do it, that it would be totally reasonable.
Absolutely.
During a rapid birth.
So it isn't like you would send somebody home waiting for them to come back into perfusion rhythm. That doesn't work here.
So you, there was a video that came up on Facebook the other day. I watched a guy in another country that resuscitated a kid for like a half hour. And while looking at this, he kept going back to stimulation. He'd work on him a couple minutes, hang him upside down, beat the hell out of him, and then go back to everything again. Is that?
And that's what I want you to take out of this thing. The idea that if you're doing a great job in terms of this right here, and if it continues to go bad, then you start a little bit of oxygen, a little blow by oxygen, and if they start not ventilating well, then you go to BVM. You go to these in step by step. You can take care of business generally right here. And worst case scenario, right here.
Are we able to just throw a mask on them and have that blow by type of oxygen while we're doing all of the rest of it? We're not worrying about free radicals or anything like
so
that.
So we'll talk a wee bit about that. The answer to that is maybe. I know you like that answer so well.
Greg.
I remember a long time ago being told that pure oxygen can cause blindness.
Yeah, and that's the rest of the story.
Yeah.
So number one, let me see if I can dispel about 99% of that. In term newborns, that's not the issue. Preemies, it is over a long period of time. The 10, 15, 20 minutes that we're going to have that kid in terms of that oxygen, doesn't matter. The idea in terms of free radicals is only if they come back into perfusion type rhythm, then yes, you're going to continue to be concerned about that. But I have to tell you that if I got this kid, and the least of my concerns is probably going to be about, least of my concerns is going to be about free radicals. So I'm going to continue to give high amount of oxygen, especially if I don't believe my pulse oximetry based on what we discussed this talking about. Right? Make sense? All right, so to that then, let's move on. I don't know when I put this together, for what I was thinking about with death. I don't use it myself, but I'll throw it out there for you all, okay? The D stands for a depressed infant that you might use drugs for. The asphyxia is that you can use something in terms of nuchal cord from a corneal staining. The T stands for possibility of birth trauma. The anamnese stands for congenital prematurity. I don't care that you remember this. I'm going to ask you about this. I think a place to stop right now. Take 5 minutes, come on back. Finish this out. This talks about what I've already told you, and that is that you can predict, looking at an APGAR score, if you have kids somewhere between that 7 and 10, that you're going to have to do minimal as far as resuscitating. Getting dry, maybe a little suctioning, perhaps just a little bit of blow by oxygen, getting it with mom, life is good. You go home with a year old. The Apgar score of 4 to 7 is that intermediate thing in terms of where they can go either way. So they can start 4 at 1 minute, or they can get worse at 5 minutes. Either way, you go back and you reevaluate, reassess, just like you've been doing for forever and ever for life. With those kids, continue drying, low by oxygen, bagging them as needed, and by bagging them with a ventilation side, 9 times out of 10, you're going to take their heart rate and you're going to shoot it up. And again, life's okay. They will start taking care of business by themselves, and all you got to do is watch them. That leaves the 10% that is the issue. So to that, an easy way, and yes, I know that you want to check for a breaker pulse, and I know that perhaps when it gets up, it's going to listen to the chest. Do yourself a favor. That cord will continue to pulsate for the next 18 hours. Put your hands around the base of the cord, and you'll get an accurate pulse, either above 100 or below 100. For the purposes of 1 minute Apgar, for the purposes of 5 minute Apgar, a real quick check. You're not hooking up a cardiac monitor at this point. You're not doing anything excessive. You're just checking for a baseline pulse. Acrocyanosis. We talked about cyanosis of the hands and the feet. Again, very, very common. No big deal. You don't need to spaz about it. It improves over a period of time, sometimes hours and days. Providing supplemental free flow oxygen as stimulation. And to Charlie's question, the idea in terms of oxygen for these kids, not a big deal. The idea in terms of blindness for this kid, not a big deal, especially for the short period of time that we got. That's not the issue.
Are we still talking 15 minutes?
No.
So
if we're doing just blow by 4 to 6 liters, we will be plenty in a mask. Yeah. All right. So walk down through this thing with me. Okay. So you have a child that's born birth. Okay. Are they term gestation? Is the amniotic fluid clear? Are they breathing or crying? Good muscle tone. If all that is yes, routine care. After our score, no big deal. Life is good. Again, you're the hero. But going down, next steps, is if that is not, I'm going to have to get close because I can't even see that myself. If no, then what's in the box there, folks, is providing warmth, positioning and clearing an airway, and drying and stimulating and repositioning. I know. So all the things we've already been talking about a couple different times this morning, stimulating them, drying them as much as possible. If it continues on, evaluating the respirations and the heart rate and the color. If their breathing and heart rate is above 100 in pink, again, observe. No big deal so far, right? So continuing on here with this evaluation, respirations, and heart rate and color. So if it's below 100, and then if it's off the side. So let's continue on with this, and then we'll go below 100. So if their breathing and heart rate is above 100 and they're pink, again, observe. If the breathing and heart rate is above 100, but they're cyanotic, and we're not talking about acrocyanosis, we're talking about profoundly blue. So their trunk is blue, their hands are blue, everything is blue about them, okay? Give them a little bit of, get a little by oxygen, and again, these kids will pink up along with stimulating. Don't just lay there and give them oxygen and not stimulate. Keep looking at your hands. And then at that point, assuming that they start to pick up again, you can go back to the observation side. So let's come down this arm right here, and then we'll come back to this persistent cyanosis. Coming down this arm right here, if they happen to be apneic or heart rate less than 100, provide positive pressure ventilation, okay? This is one breath every 3 seconds. Just enough for chest rise, one breath every 3 seconds. Back over this arm right here. We're giving supplemental oxygen along the way, and they still haven't pinked up. We're going to do the same thing. Okay. So the easy thing about VBA resuscitation, in the end, all lines up with the same arms. Okay. As they get worse and worse. Once you start bagging them, assuming that their heart rate, they start picking up, and their heart rate is greater than 100, guess what you're doing again? Observing them off. Very tail end of this thing. When the heart rate continues to either rise or not, let me get up close again so I can read that for you. Provide positive pressure ventilation and administer chest compressions. And so if the heart rate is below 60, you're starting chest compressions. If it's above 60, you continue to do ventilations and oxygen. Is going to be 15 to 2. Let me talk out both sides of my mouth here a little bit. So 15 to 2 is what they talk about AHA. American Academy of Pediatrics says that you're going to do three compressions for every ventilation. At a rate of at least 1. So fast and short. And the whole reason for it, what they suggest, is that you're ventilating more often than you're doing the chest compressions. And so that's what this kid needs. So at the very tail end of this, folks, when all this has worked, and let me guarantee you that if you get down to this right here, this is not 3 or 5 minutes into this thing. This is 5, 10, 15 minutes into this thing in terms of trying and all these other things on the way. And finally you got here in terms of the possibility of the medications. Or I should say medication. So these are things we've already talked about. These are things you should know. These are things that are paramount in terms of helping you with your resuscitation. The more you can keep them warm, the more you can keep them dry, the better off you're going to be in terms of kids that are not sick. The other thing that happens secondary to them losing heat is hypoglycemia. So at some point in time, this whole entire process, you need to be checked for a blood sugar using the IPL. And for newborns, hypoglycemia is defined as being less than 40. Whereas you and I as an adult, it's 70 or greater. Here, it's 40. This is just going back through and talking about what happens with cold. I think we've been beating that horse and we're really not alone. So there is something that's called primary versus secondary apnea. Let's talk about that. Primary versus secondary apnea. Primary apnea is where when they come out and they don't take a breath. And somehow you get them to start stimulating and they start breathing at that point. That's okay. Secondary apnea is where they come out breathing and then for whatever reason, lose the ability to breathe. Usually it's associated with hypothermia. So breathe, 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 and then they become apneic. Okay? The difference here is that primary apnea is generally no big deal. The idea is you get stimulated, start breathing, and life's good. Secondary apnea is a problem. And now once they're in that second stage, the secondary apnea, getting them back and breathing again is sometimes a big deal as far as having to bag them. Okay? So know the difference between primary and secondary apnea.
Usually
hypothermia will create the secondary apnea, yes. So in terms of shock states, the two most common shock states that you'll see in newborns is hypovolemia because of issues with fluids. And the second one is going to be cardiogenic. If they go into cardiogenic shock secondary to poor cardiac output, that is yeoman's work to get them back out of that again. Two most common. Okay, let's talk a wee bit about meconium. So meconium, like we've been talking about, is fecal material that get passed in utero. And like I told you, that the greatest share of them they do relatively well with. It's an indication there's been some sort of a fetal distress in utero. The kicker is you don't always know whether or not that was 2 minutes ago versus weeks ago. You will not necessarily know the difference. Here's the kicker. When it comes out and that you ask mom or dad about the contents of that amniotic fluid and they tell you it was almost like a pea soup type thing, that's cause of concern. That is a thick, thick type amniotic fluid that's probably going to be an issue. Versus just kind of, it was just kind of like a greenish tinge type thing. It was almost clear. Would cause me probably not quite as much alarm. Okay, so knowing the difference between the two of them, sometimes it's a big deal. Talked about this already. Back to this primary amnio. Blood pressure and heart rate does not change during this period of time. Stimulation will help take care of this. This is the problem right here. Signs and symptoms of respiratory distress in neonate include cyanosis, tachypnea, nasal flaring, grunting, and retraction. So check this out. Cyanosis, in terms of being hypoxic, definitely. Tachypneic is anything greater than 60 a minute. I have to tell you that I've seen kids in respiratory distress in NICUs that they were huffing and puffing along at 110, 120 a minute in terms of respiratory rate. So sometimes they can get up there and do okay with it. Nasal flaring, grunting, and retractions are all tied in together. All three of them are tied in together. What are they trying to do?
Breathe.
Open up the
alveoli.
Are they trying to cough? No.
Trying to eat?
How about a little peep? They're trying to develop. That's the whole thing of what these three things are about, okay? You see the nasal flaring in terms of this. The grunting is the retractions is the intercostal retractions to where you'll see them breathe in and breathe in and breathe in. It's all about PEEP and all three things, okay? It's associated with respiratory distress.
Is there like a lower level of PEEP for
Usually, if they're going to do just PEEP, they will set them before 2, 3, 4 centimeters, something like that. You don't need to remember the list here, but again, it kind of goes with some of the things we've been talking about. That some common reasons for respiratory distress might be everything above meconium maspiration, and many cases that's it. Prematurity will create this as well. If they're septic for whatever reason, that end up being respiratory distress, and so it just kind of goes along. In a longer thing, so that if this kid was septic, then there's a good chance they're going to end up having pneumonia that's associated with it. And so it kind of goes along with that. Just because they're newborns does not mean they're not going to be in this metabolic or respiratory acidosis. They will. And it doesn't change from whatever we've been talking about. It's the same exact thing. In terms of bagging these kids, getting them into this so-called sniffing position, if you end up extending the airway too much, you're going to actually close off the airway. So getting them into the sniffing position to where you have the tip of the nose just kind of up. And so getting some good cushioning, good blankets, towels, that type of thing, underneath the shoulders to close off the spot is what you need to help keep that airway open. So airtight seal, patent airway. For a few breaths, I told you that's going to require a little bit higher pressures to get the chest rise. The idea should not be excessive chest rise after that, and you want to bag about once every 3 seconds or 40 to 60 per minute. So to what Charlie had asked before, and his question was, do we stimulate these kids when they come out of the meconium stain? If you have a child that comes out, Charlie, that is very vigorous and everything else like that, let them be. At that point, you're not going to intubate this kid. You're just going to dry him off, try to suction whatever it is in his mouth, end of story. Life is okay. When these kids come out and they're lethargic and limp, they've got poor apgar, they're covered in meconium, is the time that we're going to do something. So let's kind of talk about that. So what we're doing in that case is, assuming that they're limp and there's nothing that's going on, we're going to take an ET tube and we're going to intubate them. We're going to put that ET tube in place. We're going to attach it to a meconium aspirator, which is like a little T adapter, if you will. It goes on the very end of the ET tube. We're going to hook that to suction. We're going to suction out anything that's in the gut. And at that point, we're going to make a decision. If the child continues to be limp and not doing anything at all, we're going to leave the ET tube in place. Makes sense so far? If that child starts fighting and pulling on the tube and everything else like that, at that point you make a decision about either leaving it in place or pulling it out. If the child is really, really vigorous along the way, there's probably no need to leave that EP tube in place. The other thing you can do is once you have suctioned out the contents within the lungs, then you can start bagging it if you need to. You've got your tube in place and you can start bagging them once every 3 seconds.
Yeah. You go back to the slide.
Yep.
So there, the very first step,
yep.
You're saying that there's oxygen.
We
don't, right? Okay.
We okay with this? And again, we'll practice this in lab, so don't spit out just quite yet.
We're suctioning the airway, the mouth, the area beforehand. Are you okay to do on that?
Maybe before you intubate them?
Yeah.
So maybe while you're getting a tube set up, you have somebody just do a little bit of suction. But I wouldn't do a deep suctioning. I would
right.
not cause them to gag and stimulate that.
Right.
Just around the mouth. So what else would you be doing while you're getting ready to do this? What's one other thing that you would want to do?
Warm.
Would you want to stimulate them?
No.
Probably not so much. But would you want to at least get them covered with some blankets or lights up? Yeah. So hypothermia, yet again, is something that will crop up.
Okay.
No stimulation, but you want to cover them up. So all they're talking about here is putting an NG tube, OG tube in place to empty whatever contents are in the belly. We used to do this routinely with all the kids that we had, just to empty the contents, and they definitely got away from that over the years. So I have to share something that's really gross. Now we've talked about meconium. So they have something that's called a delete trap, or did, and I don't know if they still do or not. A delete trap was this little canister of about, 10 to 12 cc's. And it had two different hoses. And one was a mouthpiece to you. The other one was the tube that you ended up putting into the gut. And you would suction that out. It's called a delete trap. I don't think with all infectious disease these days, I don't think that one would exist. But I have to tell you that a time or two, I've tasted salty MNS fluid. Not pleasant.
They still make them
for
the nose for the parents to suction out.
Huh?
They still make them for you to suction out gunk out of the nose.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, for parents.
Yeah.
You know? How do they do it? No way.
My grandpa did that. He like just stuck his face over my cousin's nose and just...
That's even worse. That's a lot of
time. That's
a lot
right there.
Yeah. It's a humane.
You just take this to a whole different level.
Was this before suction units that carried on VMS vehicles?
This was before McCoy's aspirator was carried on. So it was the only game in town. It isn't like you had a whole lot of work, right?
Yeah.
In
the vacuum.
All right. So we've talked about this, and you should understand this, the idea that if it hangs out at 60 with ventilations on board, you start compressions. So in terms of CPR, you can do it one of two ways. You can either do it with two finger widths at the usual place that you would have, but you can also do circle. As we're talking about needle resuscitation, as we're talking about this, I want you to get into the habit of doing the circling of hands on the chest. Much more effective and much more apt to use in terms of two person versus one person. Okay? So we'll work both ways, but this is the way that I want you to remember. And this is the other way. 1/3 of the interior diameter. They talk about 90 compressions and 30 breaths. The idea that stiff it has gone to at least 100 to 120, even on newborns. And by the way, this talks about 1/3 of the diameter in a newborn. That's somewhere about an inch. And so while that seems fairly deep, that's exactly what I want to do in terms of pushing hard and pushing fast. Talked about this already. The umbilical vein can be catheterized. We're going to talk about that. We'll get into that. What they typically use on most things is a feeding tube. What we'll end up teaching you is the tip of an IV catheter. And that's exactly what they're doing there. So this will continue to ooze. What they are doing here is, if this is something that's called an umbilical tape, and all this is a little bit of ligature, and you're taping around the base of the embolicus, just enough to stop the bleeding. But this will continue to ooze while you're doing it. Okay, so we're just tying it off, just so that you can get a line started into it.
Your catheter should be deeper than that, correct?
Yes.
Deeper than that. All right.
So, epi. If you need to go with epinephrine, you need to know the dose. Yes, there's Braswell. Yes, you're dependent on Braswell. But for class purposes, you need to know 0.1 to 0.3 milligrams per kilogram of 1 to 10,000.
Okay, so how are we going to decimate the weight of this
noodle? Are they usually like 3 to 4 kilograms tops usually?
So if you come out and it's a term newborn, everything else like that, you can guesstimate that they're going to be somewhere between 3 and 4 kilograms.
Okay.
If they're premium, then all bets are off in terms of having to decide that weight.
You say 3 to 4 kilograms?
Yeah. On average.
Mm-hmm. That's full term.
Yep.
So on that note, with adults, you know, when it's older, in the other range, that it's not really harmful to go to the top end if you potentially OD them a little bit.
Yeah.
What about with...
So it really does not make that much of a difference. If you've gotten here, you've got some bigger problems with it, right? So that probably would be the least of your concerns in terms of whatever they're ranking.
But we're not going to, like, potentially be harmed by...
One versus the other.
On the dose?
No.
Okay.
All right, so check one other thing out. What's another way that you get access? Do you just access these kids?
IO?
Yeah, so...
What about
logic says that, right?
Yeah,
like, logic says that, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the smallest you can go to with an easy IO is 3 kilograms. That means about roughly a 6-pound kit or so, okay? Anything below that, you cannot use an easy IO. So that option will be gone for 3 weeks for a small kit. 3 kilograms?
No.
So, yes, you can do Venus. The idea that they have some pretty good scalp things, they have pretty good ACs, they have some pretty good veins in the lower extremities, that's another possibility. But again, if you're not practicing this every day, it's pretty difficult in terms of getting those peripheral lines started. And I would dare say that I would have to work at it these days. So here's the other thing you need to know. When we give fluids for newborns, 10 mils per kg. 10 mils per kg. Over 5 to 10 minutes. Do not be concerned about bicarb. If you get there, we're going to be using Roswell for it. I'm going to talk about it right now. Naloxone, not routinely recommended. So we talked about this earlier in terms of giving Narcan, and back in the day, we were giving Narcan all the time, especially if we suspected that mom was hooked up on it. But what's the downside for doing it?
Withdrawals.
Yeah, so not only withdrawals, but seizures that go along with that. So you can put them right into a seizure based on giving the Narcan along the way. So routinely, it's not suggested, okay? How would you get around that? Or when would you want to think about it? I'd be thinking about medical control, right? The idea that I think this child's going to do relatively well as I can give a dose of Narcan, okay? Are you going to be awful dang busy during that entire time? Yeah. But the idea is that one way of getting around it. 2 to 4 mils per kg of either D25 or D10. I'm sorry, I gave you the wrong dose. So D25 is 2 to 4 mils per kg. D10 is 2 mils per kg.
That we were doing.
Yep, D10 is preferred way to go. But D25 is still out there and still talked about. So I want you to know both ways. D5 is not a great viewpoint. That is not a great way to go. And I told you already that they're considered to be hypoglycemic less than 40 mils. So what are reasons that you can have kids that are depressed? Well, by now you should understand that hypothermia, and there's hypothermia, oh, by the way, there's hypothermia, alcohol and drugs by mom. She's a pretty crazy thing about that. Assuming that we can get her obstetrician back in from the other day to talk about this, she'll talk about the number of meth babies that they're having. She'll talk about the number of moms that are walking in with absolutely no prenatal care. And our burden of kids at the end of withdrawal. Alcohol withdrawal, nasty, nasty, nasty stuff. These kids, mom has been hooked up on alcohol throughout the pregnancy, and these kids end up going through withdrawal. And just ugly. Sepsis is scary. Sepsis is kind of like a quiet killer in a lot of ways. And like you have these kids that come out, they do relatively well in the first hour or two, and then they start doing this small decline, and small decline, and small decline, they get worse and worse and worse, to the point of becoming lethargic. And unlike you and I, that typically with infection, our WBCs will kick in and let it be okay. These kids don't have that mature immune system, and so they will end up succumbing to sepsis within a short period of time. And so being on your A game, as far as knowing the possibilities, is a big deal here.
Are they
going to
have a fever with that?
That's a crazy thing, no. They don't have the ability to regulate the temperature well, and so, excuse me, instead of having a fever, they have to be hypothermic. 96.5, 96 type thing, is suspicion of this. Okay. Talk about the surviving. If they come out vigorous and crying, no big deal. If they come out depressed, you're not dry, you're not stimulate, go straight to intubating them. If you're sucking no more than 5 to 10 seconds at a time, just like we've done with adults. So all they're talking about here is instances of hypoglycemia. We talked about this the other day with gestational diabetics, that they become hypoglycemic pulse. But generally for us, by the time that we're going to get this child somewhere else, it's not going to be a big deal. Nevertheless, if you have a child that becomes depressed over a period of time, especially with mother of a diabetic or gestational diabetic, you need to be thinking about the possibility of them being hypoglycemic. And oh, by the way, if they get cold, they will become hypoglycemic in a hurry.
What's LGA?
Large for gestational age. And SGA is small for gestational age. You're not going to know that, especially. And we talked about this. We talked about sepsis. Strep B is a major killer for newborns. Meningitis is scary, scary, scary. The unit that I work in, we had a case one summer where we had three kids that ended up with bacterial meningitis. Two of them died. One of them was on a ventilator for about 7 days or so. Bad, bad stuff. So one of the things, and the crazy thing about bacterial meningitis in a newborn, even small child, is they will not feed well. They have this high-pitched cry, and not to make fun of it, but if you ever happen to, I know none of you in here would, but if you ever happen to hint a cat, that high-pitched scream that you heard about the cat, that's this. I can see in your face, Jory.
Not me, my brother was a jerk.
My
cat on fire, and then put her up by throwing her in the
toilet. So we've talked about this, and so I'm not gonna beat this anymore. Talked about this. respiratory distress. Multiple gestations. So the idea, and I mentioned this the other day, the idea, multiple gestations, they will try to get them birthed by 35, 36 weeks just because there's so much baby there. So they're dealing with a preterm kid. If they happen to birth in the field, you've got a couple different issues. Number one, you've got prematurity. Number two, we talked about the other day, for the second child or third child, you have the possibility to pull out cord. And so think about your resources. Think about what you want to get there. Think about some other hands that you want to get there in terms of that. So and my way, one way of kind of communicating that to you is, that's a small MCI in terms of resources you want to get to that scene. So you've got to be thinking about that. Getting lifeline involved, getting a number of different resources to come alongside you.
Get towel delivery service.
Absolutely. Now, okay, let's remember this. I guess the one thing I want to say about seizures is newborns will not see, 99% of the time, newborns will not seize with a grand mal seizure. And it's very, very odd type look in terms of the just kind of stop and stare into space. And sometimes you'll see a twitching of the arm, and sometimes you'll see a little bit of arching of the back. But in terms of grand mal seizure, not so much. Right? So again, you have to be highly suspicious when you see a little bit of odd behavior in these kids. I don't care if you remember this. I don't care if you remember that. I don't care if you remember that. If you're going to end up taking care of seizures, it'd be no different in that you're going to use your benzos. And you would end up turning towards, you don't need to remember the dose, you would end up turning towards Roswell in terms of dosing for your benzos. And it should be. It should be there in terms of percent, it should be there in terms of add of that. This just talks about a number of different injuries that can take place with newborns. And sometimes, especially with big old babies, they can end up having this brachial plexus injuries that happen as they come down through the birth canal just because they're so big. Sometimes you can see it in terms of, and this is usually self-limiting in terms of their facial nerve, again, secondary to a big old baby. Cephalohematoma is a bruising on the head that takes place because of coming down through the birth canal. The idea that, especially in hospital where they use forceps on heads to pull them out, we'll call bruising about the top of the head. And so the bruising gets worse and worse over a period of time. And bilirubin will end up accumulating along the way. And so that's part of what happens, routine type stuff that happens with newborn. How that might affect you is this. You can end up getting called for a child that has a lot of bilirubin, is very, very jaundiced along the way, and end up getting called in a pre-hospital setting for my baby is yellow. And so part of that is just bilirubin, they end up putting them under bright lights to try to get that down. So that's kind of the norm. Okay, so real quickly, we have the very tail end of this thing. High risk infants at home. What does this mean to you in terms of them going home and you encountering?
They're going to go home and then something's going
to
go wrong.
Yeah, like what?
First time parents
out. Right? Because they've come out of the NICU to where everybody had eyes on that child for 30 days, right? And the child was breathing or not breathing, and so it sets parents up in terms of not sleeping, right? What else?
There's a lot of other things involved. You get a kid to move to the NICU, then maybe the feeding pump, apnea monitors. I mean, I know they sent us home with a freaking suction machine with like
a
yarn
or
house for a couple of years.
So your home is turned into like a small NICU in terms of all the equipment. And I'm guessing that most of you would not be terribly comfortable in terms of using most of the equipment. So who are you turning to in terms of your SPD? Mom and dad, caregivers, or whoever else is in that house. Okay. So to that, depend on them and get a good history from them based on what's going on. It's crazy, crazy, crazy these days in terms of kids that used to live in NICUs for months and months and months and are now home on feeding tubes, on pick lines, on a number of different things. There's no way they used to do that. And so all that has changed in terms of possibility of what you're walking into as far as the home goes. Then they go home on vents, trachs. Trachs are very, very common. So the idea that if you have especially a preemie who's been on a vent for a long, long period of time, they'll end up with a trach. And so, again, it's very, very common. What's probably the biggest problem you're going to get called for in terms of trachs? Yeah, so some sort of thing in terms of suction, right? So having a replacement of the trachs, and that's what we'll get into both with adults and kids in the coming days. Home apnea monitors. Lee, did you experience that?
We should have had one, we didn't.
What, do you know what it is?
It's just the monitors, their respiratory rate goes off.
Yeah, so check this out. And there's good news and bad news about it, and it was back in the days with preemies as well. But there's a pad that lays underneath the kid. And so newborns are supposed to breathe once by themselves. It's considered to be apnea if they don't breathe greater than 15 seconds. So up to that point, it's completely normal. And if you ever watch your newborns in terms of breathing, it's irregular. And so to that, if it goes greater than 15 seconds, then the alarm goes off. That's a good news. I mean, it's saved lives, and let's be honest about that. The downside is this, because kids breathe irregular, and this thing goes off on a ongoing type basis, it drives parents crazy in terms of my child's getting ready to die. And you, in turn, get called because parents are tired of listening to that monitor.
So the angel monitor, it's the baby monitor now that everybody buys. Everybody just buys one.
Yeah.
And you'd be surprised how often people think their baby isn't breathing.
I mean, knowing about kids and how they breathe, absolutely, I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah.
So what are possible issues at home? Infection and sepsis? What's that here to thrive?
They're generally not doing well.
Not eating well.
not adapting to mom and dad well. Okay. So everything is a failure. It's not just eating, but it's everything. Failure to thrive, do not do well. Dehydration secondary to vomiting or diarrhea. We'll talk about it next week with Pete, but let me just throw it out here, and then I won't ask you about it on the email side, but it's coming. So kids with a fever, and I told you neonates do not typically have a fever, but kids with a fever 3 months or less should be assumed to have meningitis until proven otherwise. Kids with a fever 3 months or less should be assumed to have meningitis until proven otherwise. Seizures, and then finally child abuse. So check this out. Sad fact. Just like an old B the other day, I was talking about the fact that abuse by partners up about a third of the time during pregnancies. Same thing in terms of child abuse. If you somehow think that the preemies are warm and cuddly and easy to take care of, they're not. They're a pain in the ass, quite honestly. They're hard. They're hard to deal with. They're always screaming and crying. And that's inside of the NICU. At home, to where parents are the only game in town in terms of taking care of their special needs and anybody else in the house and financially, and it just goes on and on. It's not easy. There's nothing easy about taking care of these kids. And so the incidence of child abuse in preemies especially, but special needs in general, increases dramatically. So you walk into a home, you have to know that that's a possibility in terms of that. We'll talk the next hour in terms of child abuse, unfortunately. But this all leads to the possibility of the child abuse setting. I remember a kid that we had that was born at 28 weeks, and this was an active duty military guy, a captain, and a pilot on top of it. And we had their kid for probably two and a half months in the NICU, and the relationship seemed to be okay between mom and dad, and between mom and dad and child. And they got home, and dad ended up killing this kid secondary to shaken baby syndrome, and was serving 10 to 12 years. That's how this can end up. And so be on your guard in terms of walking into these homes for all the stress that's going on. Make sense? That's enough of that. Questions? Persistent fetal circulation is always, always, always the difficult thing out of this lecture. go back and take a look at that stuff, make sure that you got it straight. I am going to ask you questions about it. Okay? So you've got an option. We've got one more lecture to do on child abuse. That's going to take roughly an hour. So you can do a lunch break and then come back, or we can plow through right now. Which way you want to go?
Either way.
I always like eating, so.